Morning, morning colleagues, morning friends. I was very, very encouraged by the talk that I heard from both Rajesh Mansoor and Mr. Sahni. To a certain extent, I think Mr. Sahni has clearly echoed some of the things that I was going to raise. So the way we think about it, I work in a very narrow area, by the way. I work in a firm which is specifically focused, it's a social enterprise. It is focused on assisting low-income workers to accumulate micro savings for their old age. That's all we do. We don't do anything else. But we started this in 2006. Before that, we were doing some work in pension reforms at a policy level. In 2006, when we started, we didn't really have other than a mission statement saying we must help low-income excluded workers to save for old age. Other than that, we didn't really know exactly how we were going to do it. It's only now when we stand in 2013, some of the picture is seeming clearer, and I think we are beginning to see how the dots get connected, but that's only with the benefit of hindsight. But when we were standing along the way, one of the things that have occurred to me, and I think as I'm growing older, I'm getting more skeptical, but financial inclusion, depending on where and who I was sitting with at which point in time, seemed to be a very different story every time. If I was sitting in Ministry of Finance, it meant something different. Ministry of Social Justice was slightly different. In RBI, it was different. In PFRD. So I felt it's like the six blind men of Calcutta and with one elephant. And everybody has a certain view of how, what they see or what they feel financial inclusion really means. Now when I look at 2013, maybe there is some more light in the room and we are probably able to see more clearly that we are dealing with an elephant. It's not a rope, it's not just bank accounts, it's not about just payments, it's not just about ID. All of these seem to be extremely important pieces of a solution which will assist in financial inclusion. So what I'll do is I have a problem with brevity, so I will request the moderator to please nudge me when I'm overstepping my time. So this is the pension coverage landscape as it currently looks. Okay, so this is a chart with four colors. The orange is really the population of people who currently are excluded from formal pension programs, but have some ability to accumulate a small amount of money out of their incomes for their old age. The white are people who are unpaid family members, do not derive any cash incomes and therefore can't save for old age, and also includes people who are already above 60 and are still in the workforce. Both of these categories really, I think this, it does, accumulating savings for old age doesn't work for the people who are in the white band. Then I have a green band, which is really the lifetime poor. These are people who could be interested, should be interested to save for their old age, are deeply concerned about what they're going to do once they're unable to work, but they just don't have enough savings. In fact, most of them will be dissavers and will never be able to accumulate enough savings for an above poverty annuity. And then I have a blue in this chart, which is really the civil servants, most of the panel here, and people who are in the armed forces, or in government service more generally, or in larger firms. These are people who are covered by a pension program, and they will receive a pension when they're old. So out of these four colors, blue is the only population which has some hope of not outliving their savings. For the rest, whether you are in the orange or the saffron or the white or the green, this seems to be the general retirement portfolio. So when I go and talk to a rickshawala, or I go and talk to a maid in a household, or I talk to somebody who's a vegetable vendor, the retirement portfolio looks something like this. And you say, okay, what are you thinking about your old age? Well, children, I think they will take care of me. There's also God, and there is kismat, and perhaps the government. So this seems to be the kind of retirement portfolio. Quite naturally, this is the kind of retirement outcomes most of these people are already deriving, or this is the kind of retirement outcome that most of the people in the three large bands in the chart we saw will have. So this is the kind of retirement. So you'll see most of these people will be working in their 60s, will continue to work in their 70s, will continue to work in their 80s, and will in effect continue to work till they die, because the moment they stop working, they will not be able to survive. So the alternative, this is the alternative that we thought. And this is where I think, as I'm growing older, maybe I'm becoming less skeptical, and I'm beginning to see the light in that room, is imagine a young worker today, somebody who's age 25, he or she opens a pension account and starts saving a small part of her income month after month over many years, over multiple decades. Even if she changes her job or location, she will have a secure, convenient, and affordable way by which to put 100 rupees, 200 rupees, 50 rupees, 500 rupees, whatever is the amount that she can save. She should be able to save this whenever she has the money. And this money should directly, without the risk of fraud or theft, reach a particular regulated financial institution. Her micro savings that she puts in month after month should continue to be invested in her own name with in a regulated, customized financial product, which will give her, hopefully, inflation-adjusted returns. And these savings will grow over a period of time. Compounding is a lovely thing. So even if you're saving 100 rupees a year, a month, at the age of 20, the chances of you being non-poor are very, very bright. Okay? So this money will grow over a period of time. When this person is old, she should be able to stop working when she thinks that she's unable to work anymore. And or she thinks that she's accumulated enough savings. And thereafter, automatically, money should start flowing into her own account. And she should be able to start deriving a monthly pension for the rest of her life. During this entire process, if she has any questions, concerns, complaints, etc., she should have a very simple and easy way of getting past those problems. And this should be very effective. So I think the difference in this story really is one missing piece. So if I see five people in that room with that elephant, I think one of the things which we are seemingly ignoring is that we're dealing with an elephant. We have an elephant in the room, and the elephant in the room really is the everyday Indian. So how do we make sure, whether we're talking about banking outreach, so the way I look at it is we seem to be spending an incredible amount of effort, as we correctly should, in solving a large part of the problem, but I still see the glass as half full. So I still see that where I have large banking outreach, where I have millions of VCs, I have good political will, I have policy environment which is conducive, I have a good strong payments backbone, I have a UIDAI which gives me IDs, KYC, etc. I have a plethora of financial services which are available. I see a large latent demand, and I see telecom, mobile, technology, all of this is really sitting on one side of the road. This is, if it comes together, firstly, one, it all has to come together very, very nicely. Second, on the other side of the road, are these 300-400 million Indians who currently want to save for their old age or want financial services? And for all this to work, somebody has to cross that road. So either you have to have these 400 million people who should look at this entire supply side and say, okay, this is what I want, and I should be able to walk across the road and get it. Or somebody from the supply side has to cross the road and walk over to the other side and do it. So I won't bore you with this. I have this tendency of putting too many words in my slides. But broadly, what was happening in this story, if you saw, was that one, for a person to, at age 20 or 22, to decide that she needs to save for her old age, needs an incredible amount of education and knowledge about the importance of old age. So somebody has to walk across the road and start talking to her and saying, because if I'm a vegetable vendor and you give me a bank account with a UID, nothing changes in my life. Maybe if I'm getting some subsidy or if I'm getting some cash transfers, very nice. But beyond that, most of the risks that I'm facing, for which products are easily available, nothing changes. I still continue to get incomes in cash. I still continue to spend in cash. So therefore, my ability or interest in opening or using that bank account really is very low. So if you want to put reality the way we think about it, one, let's arm the person with financial knowledge. Let's arm her with clear awareness about features and services of the products that she's buying. This is going to be incredibly important. The second, I think, which is again a critical piece, so once I've joined the scheme, one of the things that we see is that it's very difficult to measure knowledge. So one of the simple things that we do in MicroPensions, we've got about 5 lakh people, so we're, I mean, Rajesh Bansal was talking numbers which I was keeling over at. We just have 5 lakh low-income people in some districts who are currently saving with us. But one of the key things is, how do we verify that Parvati Ben, who's enrolled for a pension program, clearly understands the program, clearly understands her rights, clearly understands what to do, who to speak to if there is a problem, clearly understands who's managing the money, etc., etc. So for that, sure, I'm through actually, I just
thank
have
you.
2-3 slides. So how do we make sure that this is actually done nicely? So one is to be able to, so we just simply do concurrent audits. We call up Parvati, have you been enrolled, what have you understood about the scheme, and so on and so forth. Thereafter, all we did was we started working with bank accounts. And thereafter, what we've done is we've created a prepaid card-based solution. I'm very pleased to know that UID is already working on this. So when somebody saves her old age, she just gets a prepaid card. It's a simple prepaid card. It works on a mobile platform. And this is the POS device that we've developed with Visa. So this attaches itself to a phone, and the person walks up to a payment outlet, says, please put 200 rupees in my account. Once she knows that she's saving her old age, she puts 200 rupees into her account. I just swipe the card on this, and instantly the money is digitized. So I've got tribals and needyaries, for instance, who are saving for old age. When they put 200 rupees in their account, and the banks are 90 kilometers away in Uti, then her money is instantly transferred into her card and instantly into a bank account. By end of day, this money is sitting in the State Bank or something else, in her own name. So all I'm saying is, if we can start thinking a little more clearly about how we can achieve achieve and crack the demand side of the problem, I have a feeling we'll get. So I had some story about this growth, but I'll avoid this in the context of brevity. But what I feel is that I think if we can just put these two pieces together, this incredibly interesting supply piece together with what we are seeing on the demand side, where we're seeing 400 million people really hungry for financial services and solutions, I think this is the kind of an outcome that we can get. And this is certainly the kind of an outcome that we should target. Thank you very much.